The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. All I can give you, I give. Heart of my heart, were it more, love that should help you to live, a song that should help you to soar. The poet sings of love without limit, but how much can you give to a loved one? Happiness, fulfillment, even life itself. Sometimes the greatest gift can be death.
I told you, Juliet, Lester is not a man to be trusted.
Please. He might as well fall in love with her as with anyone else.
Your husband and your best friend? It doesn't bother you to see them in each other's arms.
I must not be jealous or small-minded. All of this with her is meaningless.
Of course it is, dear, if you say so.
Our mystery drama, Poor Lester, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Sam Dan and stars Terry Keane and Norman Rose. I'll be back shortly with Act One. The French have a saying, "The one who is absent is always wrong." This has inspired a number of similar aphorisms, including the one that provides the text for our story. The one who survives is always guilty. Lester Keyworth is an agronomist. He sincerely believes that he knows more about scientific farming than anyone in the world. He may even be right. He is driving home from a lecture. That is, he is being driven by his wife, Juliet. And since I just happened to use that word, driven, I see that it has great application as far as Lester Keyworth is concerned. In many ways, he is a driven man.
Darling, you were marvelous.
It was an exercise in futility.
Oh, no, Lester, darling. They listened. They really listened.
Yeah, but once again, I was casting pearls before swine.
How can you say that? Didn't they honor you with the International Award?
Well, I'd rather they'd honored me less and listened to me more.
Darling, they'll see it. One day, they'll see it.
Why can't they see it now? Why do millions of people have to die first? Now, I can increase the yield of rice by at least 15% an acre on the same amount of land and cultivation now.
Darling, you're upsetting yourself.
I have been out in the field, and you know what it is?
Yes, dear, I know. Politics.
Don't brush it off so lightly.
I'm only trying... Where's he going?
Who? What?
The truck. Why, he's crazy. He's going to run us down. I'm all right.
All right, okay. Now, you just take it easy. Take it easy.
Lester. Lester, my husband. Where's my husband? He's dead, isn't he? He's dead. What have you done with my husband? Juliet. Oh, I came as soon as I heard there was an accident. I didn't know which one of you was hurt.
Louise.
How is he?
He's going to die.
Oh, no.
He can't live. The doctor told me there's been too much injury. Oh. It's only a matter of hours.
Well, but surely there's...
No, there's nothing anybody can do, and it's my fault.
Oh, no, it isn't.
It is.
I spoke to the police. They told me the driver of the truck was drunk. He jumped the divider into your lane.
It doesn't matter. It's still my fault. I was behind the wheel. I should have done something.
But there was absolutely nothing you could have done.
That truck ran us down, and he's so badly hurt he has to die. And me, look at me. Not even a single scratch. He dies and I live. Why?
I don't know.
It doesn't make any sense. It isn't right. He's the one who has something to give to the world. Me? Who am I? I'm nobody. Had he been spared, he could have saved millions of lives.
There's nothing we can do.
I would be willing to die in his place. I would give my life if it could save his.
Yes, dear.
I really would make that bargain.
Bargain? Well, but you talk as if... As if...
As if what?
Oh, well, I don't know. As if there were actually someone you can make that bargain with. But there isn't. Now, come on. We'll go down to the coffee shop and have something hot.
Alcestis.
Juliet, let's go. Alcestis? What did you say?
Oh, nothing.
Oh, no, you did. It was a word. It sounded like Alcestis. Who?
Queen Alcestis.
I'd never heard of her.
She was a queen in ancient Greece.
Oh?
Her husband's name was Admetus. And one night he lay dying, just as my husband is dying now. She prayed to the gods, to her ancient gods, to spare him. And they answered her. They said they would.
Oh, but that's all a myth. Juliet, why don't we get that coffee? You'll feel much better.
The gods agreed they would spare him if someone else were willing to take his place in the land of the dead. And she said, take me. Take me. I'm willing.
And did they?
Yes. She died for him. And I would die for Lester. But there's no one I can talk to.
Now, Juliet, get a hold of yourself.
It's how I feel. I want to go out.
Oh, yes, the air will do you good. We'll go for a little walk.
No, I want to go by myself.
It's nighttime.
Please, let me be alone. For just a little while.
All right. But be careful.
Officer, you startled me.
Yeah, well, you're lucky I'm a cop. I could have been somebody who'd do more than just startle you. What are you doing here?
Nothing.
Well, can't you find a safer place to do nothing this hour of night?
I'm just sitting here looking at the river. Is that against the law?
Well, it's against the law, common sense. Now, why don't you go home?
I don't want to go home.
It's a free country. What can I tell you? If you hear anything or see anything out of the way, scream as loud as you can. Maybe it'll help.
Alcestis. Who's that?
Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening.
May I join you?
I was just leaving.
Oh, don't go.
But I really have to.
And I was hoping we might have a little chat.
I have to go to the hospital, my husband.
There has been no change. He's still alive. Not by much, but he is still with us.
What are you saying?
Looking at you, you don't resemble her very much at all.
Resemble who?
Alcestis. Oh, no. You are much more beautiful.
I don't know what you're talking about. Who are you?
You know who I am. Zeus.
Zeus?
King of the ancient gods.
But that's impossible.
Is anything impossible for a god?
But Zeus and all those gods, they're dead.
No god is dead. If you believe in him.
Oh, no, I'm dreaming.
Are you?
Why have you come here?
You called me, and I am happy to oblige.
But why have you come?
Well, frankly, I have little choice. I have a wife, Hera, or perhaps you know her as Juno. We have children, Aphrodite, or you may have called her Venus. and Ares, Hermes. It's a long, long list. I have to support them, and I have practically no work these days.
I still don't understand.
Oh, please don't embarrass me.
Embarrass you? How?
Compared to what I was at one time, this is quite a come down. Don't force me to speak in a crass and materialistic manner.
What am I forcing you to do?
You are making me state the bald, unadorned truth, which is, we're all pretty much like a political machine. If we want the voters to support us, then we must be prepared to service the voters. Or in other words, do favors. You want to die for Lester Keyworth, just as Alcestis died for Admetus. To show you how truly I hold your interests at heart, I would like to talk you out of it.
Why?
Poor Alcestis. She wasn't really very attractive. And Admetus was a most imposing figure of a man. He married her for her father's money. The silly girl thought he adored her. Actually, she was grateful to him in the way that only a plain girl can be grateful to a handsome lover. She felt he did her a favor, and dying in his stead was her way to repay him. Did Lester Keyworth also do you a favor?
Yes.
But you are beautiful.
He's a man of genius. And he chose me for his wife. Compared to him, what am I?
You were a student in his class. He was twice your age.
I fell madly in love with him.
Were you looking for a father figure?
Certainly not.
In ancient times, people had a father figure. Me. Now that I'm abandoned, your new priests, the psychiatrists, send you on all those fruitless chases. Lester Keyworth did not do you a favor. It was the other way around. You brought him youth and freshness, which he never really took advantage of.
There's more to life than just the physical.
Perhaps, but not very much. He was a stuffy man. You have all the wisdom, the insight.
It isn't true.
Neither of you is aware of it.
I love him. I love him so much, I want to die for him.
You believe this?
I know you must think it's foolish.
Yes, but it is your foolishness, your very precious foolishness. If you desire to endow it with idealism and holiness, why, you are simply behaving like a human being. I shall permit you to die for him.
You permit me?
Yes.
Assuming, just assuming that it could be done, what am I required to do?
You are required to believe in me.
Believe in you.
You must become mine without doubt, without reservation.
But I don't believe in you.
Then how do you account for me?
You are a clever man, obviously very well educated. I have been sitting here talking to myself, and you must have overheard me. So you're creating this little joke.
Hey, lady, who are you talking to?
Officer, I'm talking to this gentleman here.
This gentleman? Which gentleman?
This gentleman who's sitting beside me on this bench.
I ask you if you are all right. You're not.
Mr. Zeus, or whatever your name is, there's something wrong with this policeman's eyesight. Please tell him that...
He cannot see me.
What do you mean?
He can't see me. He can't hear me.
Why not?
Because he hasn't sent for me.
Lady, now you sit right here. There's a call box down the street. I'm going to send for a cab, and he'll take you home whether you like it or not. Now you just sit there.
Now, do you believe in me?
Yes. Yes, I believe in you. I believe in you.
I don't know. If I were sitting out there, I'd probably believe in him, too. So it seems she's going to die for her husband. But obviously she's the heroine of our story. Can we afford to lose her so soon, right at the end of the first act? Be of good cheer. Even if she dies, I can guarantee it won't be the end of her. Act 2, very shortly. Love. To some, it's the beginning and the end. As the Roman poet Virgil said, Amor omnia vincit. Love conquers all. And this is exactly what our heroine, Juliet Keyworth, has in mind. To love, she will surrender absolutely everything. She will hold nothing back, not even her life.
Then we agree. I take your life.
What am I required to do?
You've already done it. You believe in me.
Yes.
You will die.
If it means he's going to live.
My dear Juliet, I wish I could talk you out of it.
Please hurry.
Why? You will be dead a long time.
Look down the block. The police officer is making the call.
Don't worry about the police officer.
But he'll be back here in just a minute.
Don't concern yourself with minutes. You have all of eternity.
Could I ask you a favor?
A favor?
I know I'll be dead and everything, but could I be able to see how he is afterward?
Oh.
I suppose that means I'm asking for too much.
Well, that was not in my plan.
But I just have to know.
Well, all right.
Oh, thank you.
In the old days, you wouldn't have had a prayer. But now, like everyone else, I suppose I have to offer specials.
Oh, the police officer, he's coming back. What are you going to do?
Oh, it's quite simple. We shall restage the accident.
Oh.
The automobile accident.
Do I have to go through that again?
Yes, it's the only way.
Will it hurt?
Oh, my dear, you're going to be killed. You can still change your mind. I wish you would.
No, no. Go ahead.
Listen, that's your automobile. Look closely. What do you see?
I see myself. I'm sitting in the car.
You're behind the wheel, just as you were.
Lester. I'm sitting next to Lester.
And now, look. See that truck. He's about to jump the divider. You blow the horn. And you scream.
He's crazy. He's going to hit us. No!
All right, keep moving. Just keep moving. Keep it moving.
The ambulance attendant is talking to Lester. And Lester says to him.
My wife. What? Happened to my wife.
Oh, Lester, poor Lester.
What do you mean, poor Lester? You're the one who just died.
It proves he loves me.
I thought Alcestis was bad enough, but you're in a class by yourself.
Look, we're in the hospital.
And look who's here.
It's Louise. Lester. Oh, Lester, I came as soon as I heard. I didn't know which one of you was hurt.
On the way.
How is she?
The doctor just told me. She's dead.
Oh, poor Lester.
Again, poor Lester. You're the one who just died.
Well, what's the point in feeling sorry for the dead? It's Lester who needs her sympathy now.
You know something? I believe he's going to get it.
How did it happen?
We were hit by a truck.
Oh, who was driving?
She was.
Oh, poor girl. She paid very dearly for her carelessness.
Yeah, I suppose so.
Now listen to that.
Louise never thought I was a good driver, and truthfully with some justice.
But why does he agree with her? He knows the other fellow jumped the divider.
He's obviously in a state of shock.
You can see she's not wasting any time.
What do you mean?
Now, Juliet, you know what I mean.
Oh, no. Louise is my dearest friend.
The dead have no friends. Listen.
Poor Lester. What are you going to do now?
I don't know.
Let me take you back to the house.
Isn't she sweet?
Well, he's obviously in no condition to take care of himself.
Well, have you seen enough?
You promised me.
Do you want to see more?
You agreed.
But I can tell you exactly what's going to happen.
Please.
Very well, if you insist.
Now, are you feeling better?
Yes. Yes, thank you, Louise. The soup was delicious.
You know why it was delicious, my dear Juliet. She put salt in it.
Well, she doesn't know he's supposed to be on a low-sodium diet.
Oh, she doesn't.
Now you just relax, Lester, and I'll get the kitchen cleaned up. Oh, I don't know where to begin. It's a mess. Poor Juliet. She was a lovely girl, but she certainly wasn't a neat housekeeper.
Oh, listen to your friend.
Well, it's true. I was too busy doing a great deal of work for Lester. Now, Lester, dear, you must let me set this place to rights. Oh, you look so tired. Why don't you go to bed? Rest, forget, and I'll be back here first thing in the morning to make you breakfast.
Well, one thing you have to say in her favor. At least she didn't spend the night, not the very first night you're gone. But don't wager on the second.
Louise, you're still here since this morning?
Oh, there is so much to do. Well, how does the place look?
Huh? Oh, it looks different.
Yes, do you like it this way?
Yes, I believe so.
Don't you think it looks a little more neat and orderly?
Yes, it seems to.
While Juliet was here, the decor seemed to express her personality, which was undisciplined, cluttered. Now it should reflect yours, which is orderly, precise. Does it give you that feeling?
Yes. Yes, I think it does.
And I've also tried to put a little suggestion of style into it. Do you sense it?
Yes.
Juliet was a lovely girl, but she had absolutely no concept of style.
Well, I couldn't help it. I was colorblind. You know that, Louise.
Oh, don't shout at her. She can't hear you.
But it's true, and she knows it. He knows it, too.
Remember, you wanted to be a witness to this. Have you seen enough?
No,
It isn't going to get any better.
Lester, I've gone through your wardrobe. Oh, I hope you don't mind. But may I speak frankly?
Yes, of course.
I think you need a new one.
But most of my clothes are new.
Well, I'd better not say anything. It would only reflect on Juliet.
How?
Well, didn't she choose your wardrobe?
Yes.
Oh, then that must be the end of it.
No, but Louise...
No, forget it, Lester. It's simply something I cannot discuss.
You see, I told you she was my good friend.
Darling, she believes in one task at a time. The first night, she destroys your cooking. The second, your housekeeping. Wait. The campaign is young yet.
Hello, Lester.
Louise.
Oh, may I come in?
Yes, but I was just leaving. I'm giving a lecture.
I know. That's why I'm here. How do you propose to get there?
How? Why, Juliet...
Yes?
I've forgotten.
Oh, I knew you would.
Well, it's just that she always made the arrangements, and I am really lost without her.
I have my car outside.
Oh, Louise, this is so good of you.
Do you have your notes?
No. Oh, yes.
Lester, are you going to wear that tweed jacket?
Well, I always wear it.
Oh.
Is there something wrong with it?
It's 7:30, Lester. We can just about make it.
How did it go?
Fine.
Oh, do you really think so?
What do you want me to say, Lester?
The truth.
Watch her, dear Juliet. The woman is absolutely tops in her class. See how she manages that trouble look, how she protests, how she lets him draw it out of her.
You say you want the truth. I wonder. But I'll take the chance. Let us begin, Lester, with what your audience saw tonight. They saw a man dressed in ill-fitting, seedy-looking clothes.
But these clothes, my entire wardrobe...
Was chosen by Juliet.
Yes, and they are of excellent quality.
But they don't project the proper image.
What do you mean by image?
Oh, Lester, your image is that of an eccentric, unworldly college professor, but you're talking to businessmen. And you want them to invest money in your schemes.
I think they are not schemes. They are carefully researched, fully documented, scientifically...
Any time a businessman is asked to invest money, he considers it a scheme. Not only do you present an image he doesn't approve of, you speak a jargon he cannot understand.
Well, as Juliet used to say, I'm just throwing pearls at swine.
Then why didn't she tell you to stop? As an expert in scientific farming, you know that swine derive no nourishment from pearls. Why don't you feed them what they can eat?
What? I just don't understand.
It's quite simple, darling. I know this may sound as if I'm being disloyal to my friend Juliet, but you insist on the truth. Juliet loved you, but she wanted you all to herself. She didn't want to share you with the rest of the world. She was afraid she would lose you if you became famous.
Now there is a true and loyal friend. What do you say to that, Juliet? Juliet?
It may have been true. Subconsciously, I may have been frightened.
Why are you present-day people so obsessed with the subconscious? When you worshipped us, we took care of it. But, oh, yes, Louise has reloaded and is ready for another salvo.
Juliet, without meaning to, perhaps, impeded your progress. She wrote speeches for you that were long, dry, statistical treatises. Well, tonight's fiasco is an example. She dressed you in a dull, drab, colorless costume. Lester, you need someone to take you in hand.
Have you heard enough, Juliet?
I must have been doing something wrong.
She's going to marry him.
He's not a man who can live alone. He needs a woman.
Your best friend?
The important thing is for him to succeed in his work to feed the hungry. That's why I gave my life for him. If she can help him more than I could, then I'll bless her. And I shall not have died in vain.
My poor girl. One day you'll realize that in the end, everyone dies in vain.
And on that somber philosophical note, we leave you for a brief intermission. You must admit, we are seeing selflessness on a level that is scarcely, if ever, met with here below, or even up above, for that matter. How wonderful to be loved like that. How wonderful and how terrifying. Act 3 will shortly be upon us. How do I love thee, asks the celebrated poem of Mrs. Browning, and it lists an impressive catalog of ways, ending with, and I shall but love thee better after death. This seems to be the situation with our Juliet Keyworth, who has given her life so that her husband Lester might live on. One thing the late Mrs. Keyworth is finding out, widows may pine away in loneliness, but widowers rarely go to waste.
Let me help you, Lester. Let me take you in hand. You need someone like me.
I feel so confused, so lost.
You're a man of brilliance, a man of genius.
Well, that's what Juliet used to say.
But Juliet didn't know what to do about it.
Do about it?
Oh, you and Juliet, you were such children.
Well, now, hold on a minute, Louise.
Well, I thought you liked frank conversations. Juliet humored you. I will not... Oh, Lester, don't you see why some men of ability succeed while others fail?
Well, I suppose it's luck.
It's packaging, merchandising.
But you speak as if I were a bowl of breakfast cereal.
Oh, Lester, darling, give me a chance.
A chance?
For years I've watched Juliet ruin every opportunity. What could I say? She was my friend. Let me do you over.
You'd think he was an apartment. Well, my dear Juliet, you've been remarkably quiet through all this.
What is there to say? I couldn't do anything for him.
Why couldn't he do anything for himself?
He's very unworldly.
Is that true? Or was it perhaps the way you wanted him?
I don't know.
Well, dear, that's what we're about to discover, isn't it?
Lester, let's look at you. Here, in the mirror. See? Your hair stylishly full.
Maybe I should have cut off my beard.
No. Huh? Properly trimmed, it's permissible. And the suit, neat, subdued. Oh, you'll look just like any of those people you'll be talking to tonight. Have you gone over the speech?
Yes, but I'm really not sure of it.
Well, let me hear you.
Gentlemen, this evening...
No, the authoritative voice of a man who is in full command.
Gentlemen.
Yes.
This evening, I intend to talk to you not about primitive people who have to be helped, but of a market.
Good.
An opportunity waiting to be created.
Oh, that's good.
I really don't believe a word of it.
Why not?
Well, what I'm saying is that if these people can raise enough food to keep from starving, they'll present us with a market for our manufactured goods.
Well, isn't that true?
Yes, but that's far off in the future, and, well, it isn't the reason that we should be helping them.
Why should we help them?
Because it is the right thing to do.
That was Juliet's opinion.
Well, she was right.
And where did it get you? Try it my way, Lester. What have you got to lose? Darling, I told you. Didn't I tell you?
Did you hear how they applauded?
They wouldn't stop.
I never had a reception like that before.
Oh, and this is just the beginning.
You speak our language, Professor. Yes, that's what they kept saying.
Oh, you're going to get offers.
Offers?
Yes, from foundations, from the government, from industry. Oh, Lester, you have ideas. Fresh new approaches. You'll see.
I just feel so different. Yes. Something has come over me.
Why, you look different. Oh, 20 years younger.
Oh, well, do I?
You're a very attractive man.
Louise?
Yes, Lester?
Juliet, my dear, do you want to hear this?
He might as well fall in love with her as with anyone else.
It doesn't bother you to see them in each other's arms.
I mustn't be petty or jealous. I wanted to save him so that his great work could continue. And all this with her is meaningless. Fox on the wave.
Of course it is, dear. If you say so.
Lester, I have wonderful news. You've heard of Yum Yummies.
Yum Yummies?
Yes, it's part of a gigantic food conglomerate.
Oh, yes. Well, yes, I believe so, yes.
Well, they want you.
Whatever for?
To head a distinguished board of food experts. Don't do it, Lester. They only want to trade on your name.
Juliet, how many times must I tell you? They can't hear you.
What am I required to do?
Act in an advisory capacity.
Well, my basic advice to them would be to junk the product and produce a food with genuine nutritional value.
You know, that's what Juliet would have said.
And Juliet would have been right.
She would have been wrong. You don't get your way by fighting people. You must gain their confidence and influence them.
But Yum Yummies are utterly worthless.
As a trusted, respected advisor, you could convince them to upgrade their product. Show them how it would be to their advantage.
Well, I don't know.
Oh, go back to where you were then, to being Don Quixote, a ludicrous figure tilting at windmills. Oh, darling, this could be the beginning.
The beginning?
Of Keyworth Associates, Nutritional Planners, a multi-million-dollar establishment.
But I don't want to become a mammoth corporation.
Would you rather be a small voice in the wilderness? That's what you've been all these years. Only size and stature command respect. You must create an imposing presence.
But I don't...
Don't be frightened. Lester, you must have an office. No, an imposing set of offices. In New York, on Park Avenue. An English receptionist, banks of computers, all the glamour, the glitter. Your name must become a household word.
No, wait, I don't know.
Oh, it can happen, Lester. It can happen. We can make it happen.
Keyworth Associates, good morning. Keyworth Associates, I'll connect you. Keyworth Associates. Keyworth Associates.
There he is, Lester Keyworth, a man of importance.
Well, there's nothing wrong with it.
So far, he hasn't been feeding the hungry.
So far, he's been solidifying his power base.
My, how quickly you pick up the jargon.
I know, Lester. He's an idealist at heart. You think his head has been turned by all this.
I have been here before.
He will use it for the good cause.
He is about to get that opportunity right now. Watch this.
Who are you?
Oh, sir. Please, excuse this intrusion.
How did you get in here?
I have for days been trying to see the sublime Lester Keyworth.
Now, what is this all
but
about?
The sentinel said he is not to be disturbed.
What sentinels?
Those who occupy the outer offices to keep intruders away. I know this, for I am a queen. And so, when they were not looking...
You're a queen?
I am Queen Vasantrigati of the Belan. Oh, sir, we are a tiny, tiny country to the north of India. We are a poor country, and the people starve.
Oh.
But we have the television box, and we see the magnificent Lester Keyworth speak of how he could make the food grow in the land that is dry, the land that is poor, the land that is filled with rocks.
Madam, Your Majesty...
I ask you, please, to come to our land, which is poor and dry and covered with rocks. Touch it with your magic.
Oh, Lester. Lester, this is what you always dreamed of. An invitation. A chance to go to the people.
Will the Magnificent One come?
It would require a great deal of money for expenses.
Oh, but we have no money.
Ah, well, why don't you go to Washington? See if you can raise several million dollars, come back here, and then perhaps we can have a practical discussion.
Are you telling her? What are you saying to this woman? Her people are starving.
My dear, all your passion is for nothing.
Look at him sitting there. I can't believe it.
Your Majesty, I am quite sure you can receive funding from the Foreign Aid Committee. Certainly, you have a most worthy cause.
Is this why I died for him? So he could get rich and sleep with my best friend?
I would say that's the unkindest cut of all.
Oh, I see it all now. Lester is a phony. He fooled me. I mistook his affectations, his arrogance for genius. He's not going to get away with this.
I'm afraid he already has.
I learned my lesson.
But like most human beings, you learned it too late. And now, my dear, you must go.
Go where?
Where you belong. To the kingdom of the dead.
Oh, no.
You must, since you're no longer alive. I shall escort you to the realm of my brother, Pluto.
Oh, please, you can't.
We made a bargain.
But I was cheated.
By whom? By yourself. By your own mistaken visions. Come. It's been so long since I've seen Brother Pluto.
No, I don't want to die.
But you are already dead.
Listen, you say it's been so long since you've seen Pluto.
Yes. Unfortunately, we have so little activity these days.
That's because you have so few believers out there, isn't it?
Obviously.
But I believe in you. You know that. What good am I to you? Dead.
Julie, don't try to get around me.
Can you afford to lose a single believer? Maybe I'm the only one you have left.
No, Juliet.
Remember you said, why don't the people rebuild my temples and sacrifice at my altars? Let me go back and I'll rebuild them.
You?
There's no one else.
You all by yourself?
One on God's side is a majority. Let me build the temples of Zeus.
Alone?
You have to begin somewhere. Oh, picture it. The gleaming marble temples of Zeus, once again crowded with the faithful.
Oh, please don't do this to me. Don't fill me with false hopes.
Are you afraid to come back? Do you think you can no longer run the world? Do you want to remain a has-been for all of eternity?
No.
Then send me back. Restart. stage. The accident.
Oh, Juliet.
Put me back in the car with Lester. You can do it. Do it. I hear the car.
Juliet.
Put me inside, please. Not just for me, but for you, too.
Oh, very well. Goodbye, Juliet.
It's not goodbye. It's hello, Juliet.
That truck.
He's crazy. Juliet, dear, I came as soon as I heard.
I'll bet you did.
I didn't know which one of you was...
Are you disappointed, Louise?
Oh, Juliet, darling, what are you saying?
You know what I'm saying.
But...
Lester is dead.
Oh, poor Lester.
Yes, poor Lester. But I'm alive.
Oh, yes, and for that we should all give thanks.
I plan to hold a special service.
Oh, I'm sure our minister will
want... No. Not in the church.
No? Where?
We'll have to begin modestly. In the backyard.
In the back?
I'll build an altar. I'll get some of the choicest cuts from the butcher for sacrifices.
Juliet! Oh, what are you talking about?
And afterward, you give the meat away to the needy. It makes a great deal of sense.
Oh, Juliet, are you sure you're all right?
Oh, yes, dear friend. Now I'm all right. I'm just fine.
Her friends don't think so. What with all the sacrifices to Zeus that are going on in her backyard and her fundraising activities to build a temple... They think perhaps the shock of the accident may have affected her sanity. But I must say, not everyone thinks she's crazy. Not everyone laughs at her. How many people does a religion need to be born or reborn? I shall return shortly. God created man in his image, but man also creates God in man's image. And as man's image of himself changes, so must his image of God. It's an old and difficult problem, and it's never solved to everybody's satisfaction. However, does it really matter how the image changes, just so long as the spirit remains constant? Our cast included Terry Keane, Norman Rose, Joyce Gordon, and Earl Hammond. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown.
This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.